Hey, what's up, everybody? It's your girl, Merle, and today we're going to be talking about more things about sex, because we can. We're going to be talking about sex drives in relationships. You might already have an idea of what I'm talking about here. You and your partner, maybe you really love your partner, you want to be with your partner. They're great, right? You guys are great, but maybe one of you initiates more than the other, and maybe one of you feels like you're constantly turning your partner down, or you're just not in the mood as much, and you're wondering why that is. Maybe you're feeling a little hopeless, maybe you're feeling a little frustrated or sad, and that's all okay. We're gonna be talking about this because I think this is something that most people go through. Some situation where one person said, should we, maybe, and the other person was like, I don't really want. It's totally normal. Let's just get that out of the way. Before we dive into the video, I wanna say a quick thanks to our sponsor. Today's sponsor is Beducated. They are this amazing website who basically hosts these online courses so that you and your partner, or just you, can go ahead and learn about a multitude of different subjects around sexuality. I'm gonna be telling you way more about that at the end of this video, so stick around and I'll tell you everything you need to know about this awesome company and how they can help you. First and foremost, it's very important to remember that you are not alone. According to one study in 2015, 80% of couples experienced some form of sexual discrepancy in the last month. And for some people, sexuality isn't an important part of their life at all. Asexuality is just as valid as any other form of sexuality. It's super common that a couple, especially a long-term couple, might find themselves in a situation where their sexual desire cycles aren't lining up perfectly. In other words, they just don't seem to want to have sex at the same time. This does not have to mean that things are over for you, that you are failing, or that you're not compatible. Let's get one thing straight. Almost zero couples have the exact same libido, like none. And you know why? That's because libidos are not set in stone. It's changing all the time, and your partner's is changing all the time, and you're both coming from two different places with different experiences and different turn-ons. Think about that for a second. If we let it, libido differences can lead to tension, stress, hurt feelings, feelings of rejection, arguments, resentment, and even breakups if they're not dealt with properly. Trina E. Reed is the author of a book called Till Sex Do Us Part. Great title, right? She calls it the shame, blame, flame cycle. To explain the shame, blame, flame, shame, blame, flame? To better explain the shame, blame, flame cycle, Trina E. Reed says, the person who wants to have sex feels unwanted and says something that makes the other person feel guilty or shamed. Then the shamed person blames the other. Quote, well, if you did such and such, maybe I'd want to have sex. And then comes the flame, anger, resentment, and argument. When we think about the things that affect our sexuality, it's not just as simple as like, am I in the mood? Am I not in the mood? It's like, what's making me in the mood and what's making me not in the mood? What's making my partner feel turned on right now and what's making me not feel turned on right now? Why do I not feel like having sex and they do? Turns out there are a lot of factors that can come into play when it comes to sexuality. For example, Robin Milhausen, who is a sex researcher at the University of Guelph, really hoping I pronounced that correctly, says, my research found about 115 factors, including setting and mood, but also what you learned about sex in school, attitudes your parents had, and how open your religious, cultural, or ethnic background has been to you expressing yourself sexually. And there is also age. There's a lot that comes into play when it comes to sexuality and what's gonna affect your sexuality in any given moment. And of course, we all know about the honeymoon phase, right? It's when a relationship first starts and you're really excited and you got those butterflies and you're still learning about your partner and you're excited, it's new, it's thrilling, it's amazing. Maybe you're having sex all the time. Maybe you're having sex in places you wouldn't normally have sex. The honeymoon phase is great, but it doesn't last forever. And that's okay. It's not supposed to last forever. It is totally normal for you and your partner's sex life to change after the initial 6 months, 3 months, 2 years, whatever that honeymoon phase looks like for you. And by no means does that mean your sex life has to get worse. It's just gonna be different. But before we talk about how to get back on the same page sexually with your partner, I think it's really important that we understand just how varied sexual desire can be and just how normal that is. Sexuality, like most things in life, is a whole spectrum. On one end of the spectrum, we've got asexuality. And asexuality in itself is a whole spectrum as well. Those on the asexuality spectrum may feel little to no desire to engage sexually with another person. Then we have people who may have slightly more interest in sexual activity, a little more sexual desire, but not enough necessarily for them to go out of their way to masturbate or to seek out a sexual relationship with someone else. Then, moving further down the spectrum, we've got people who have the occasional sexual urge. Maybe they, you know, initiate sex with their partner, but just on occasion. On the far end of the spectrum, we've got people who are constantly thinking, engaging in, and passionate about sexual activity. There are many people that fall in between these little descriptions I just gave you. Not one size fits all for anyone. You're not broken, you're good. There's this show on Netflix now that's called Sex, Love, and Goop. Say what you will about Gwyneth Paltrow, whatever your thoughts may be around Goop, but I will say that this series on Netflix is amazing, really eye-opening, very educational. So in the first episode, they bring in a somatic sexologist, an educator named Jaya, who talks about her whole theory around the erotic blueprint. The five prime blueprints that Jaya focuses on are the energetic, which is people who are turned on by anticipation or yearning, the sensual, those who are turned on by their senses being ignited, such as touch, smell, taste, etc. Sexual, which is people who are turned on by the things that we think of as sex in our culture, like nudity, ejaculation, genitals, penetration. Then we have kinky. And those with a kinky erotic blueprint are interested in anything taboo. And then finally, we've got the shapeshifters, and that's the people who are turned on by all of it. And I will also say, it's not like we are just one of these things. We have a certain percentage for each of these blueprint categories. Now, what I found to be really interesting was that each of these blueprints has a shadow side. I found it easier to figure out what my erotic blueprint was by learning about what the shadow side of all of these were. For example, the shadow side of the sensual blueprint is being in your head. That is me. Anyway, I'll let you look into the erotic blueprints on your own time. I'm confident that this could help you and your partner better understand each other. In a similar vein, Emily Nagoski, who I talk about a lot, she wrote this book, Come As You Are, and one of her principal teachings is about sexual breaks and sexual accelerators. So what turns you on and what turns you off. Nagoski has this amazing test in her book, Come As You Are. Just buy the book, it's so good. I talk about it every single time I do a video about sex. And there's this awesome test in there that'll help you to see how sensitive your accelerators are and how sensitive your brakes are. And then you can look at what you and your partner scored and you can understand each other there too. There's just so much you can learn. There's so much to learn. Another thing that Emily Nagoski talks about a lot is spontaneous versus responsive desire. This is a big one. So buckle up. You know, in movies, when you see a young couple and they both see each other, they're both horny, the same time, miraculously, they come together, they rip each other's clothes off, they start voraciously making out. She's somehow orgasming within like 3 seconds, and he's orgasming too, and they do it at the same time, and it's fireworks, and it's easy. And that's your cue in the movie or the show to be like, oh, they're in a happy relationship. Then, cut to the couple where the guy initiates and the woman turns him down. She's too tired, you know, she's been so stressed from work. And that's your cue in the movie to be like, oh, they're struggling. Something's failing in their relationship. That's not fair. First of all, the first scenario where the couple is just magically turned on at the same time, they just both know what the other person wants. That doesn't exist. And then in the other case, that's the more relatable scenario, you know? Like somebody's tired, somebody's stressed, you're on different pages on a given day. That doesn't mean you're in a failed relationship. That's just life. We're so busy all the time. So it bums me out that we've got this unrealistic expectation up here saying this is what successful relationship looks like. And then we've got this other situation up here that's very common. Totally normal, and that's our indicator of like a failed relationship. Throw those both away, dispose. I have spoken to a lot of friends over the years about how they feel insecure or upset or nervous or disappointed because they feel like they've lost the spark or they've lost that sexual desire piece with their partner. First of all, it's okay to not want to have sex all the time. Let's just get that one thing straight. And we don't know how to explore sexuality together. We think sex has to be one black and white thing. And it's that two people want to have sex at the same time and you both orgasm. And that's bullshit. Let's talk about spontaneous desire. Someone with spontaneous desire might simply see someone sexy or see the loving partner and then boom, they are just ready for sex. Around 75% of men have this, and 15% of women. Then we have a group of people who don't experience spontaneous desire. they don't actually experience desire until sexy things are already happening. Maybe that's foreplay. Maybe that's a nice little bathtub session with your partner. This response of desire is true for about 5% of men and 30% of women. And then the remaining 20% of men and 55% of women likely fall into the category of contextual desire. For these people, their sexual desire depends heavily on the situation that they find themselves in. For example, for some people, midday stress, busy day work, a quick sexual dalliance could actually help to bust that stress, could actually help them be more productive, could actually help them get out of their head. For others, that would be a nightmare. In a stressful environment, sex would be the lowest on their list of priorities. It really depends on the person. So why do we feel the need to live up to this spontaneous desire? Why do we feel like if we're not ripping our partner's clothes off the second they get home and having quick, easy, loud orgasms that we're somehow failing? As Emily Nagoski puts it best, the norm is heavily based off of men's experience. Don't forget, we live in a goddamn patriarchy, people. And considering 75% of them tend to experience spontaneous desire, that's what's portrayed in books, movies, shows as the norm. Don't forget, in 2020, 78.9% of the movie directors and theatrical films were male. Men movie reviewers outnumber women 2-1. In 2019, 80.6% of screenwriters were men and only 19.4% were women. White men are 30% of the US population, but 62% of office holders. Kind of makes more sense in that context, doesn't it? The people who control the media we consume are setting the standard. It's racist, it's cis heteronormative, it's the life we live. So we need to break out of those ridiculous, unrealistic, non-inclusive standards and find what our own normal looks like and be proud of it. And fight for people to understand that that's not the norm. Have these conversations, talk to people, talk to your partner, but talk to your friends. Make sex normalized so that people can talk about the sex they're actually having and not the sex they're pretending they're having or forcing themselves to have. Then of course, we have terrible sex education. So basic understanding of the human pleasure anatomy is sorely lacking. We're not learning how to have great sex. We're just learning the biological definition of what sex is from a reproductive standpoint. So what are some next steps? What are some things that you can do, either on your own or with your partner, to make your sex life more gratifying? First and foremost, get used to talking about sex. It's good, it's healthy, it's normal. You can talk about sex with your friends. You can talk about sex with your partner. You can talk about sex with your family. You can talk about sex with a sex therapist. You could journal about it. Just anything to start bringing sex into the present will give you a better chance of finding that happiness in the future. It's not your fault if you grew up in an environment where talking about sex wasn't normal, but it is your responsibility to start normalizing it for yourself. Realistically, how do we hope to have a long-lasting, exciting, fun sex life with our partner if we're not able to express our sexual likes, dislikes, wants, goals, dreams, desires, etc.? Consider talking to a sex therapist, either by yourself or with your partner. If you and your partner don't know where to start, it can be really helpful to have a professional there to help you mediate these conversations and to give you some unbiased and honest feedback. And there's a lot of stigma around couples therapy or couples sex therapy. Screw that. I think if you have an incredible resource right there that could help you be happier, why not take it? If you don't feel comfortable telling anyone, don't. Or do, and normalize it for other people. Another thing a lot of sex educators and sex coaches will recommend is planning sex dates. The goal of this is to disrupt the habit or the ritual we get sometimes of like, oh, I'm too tired to do it tonight, but tomorrow night we're definitely gonna have sex. And then the next night you're also so tired, but maybe this weekend. And then it just keeps getting pushed and pushed and pushed and pushed. When you plan your sex dates, think of it as sacred and treat it as seriously as you would any other professional appointment. So pick a time that's gonna work for both of you. Just make sure it's a time that you both will have motivation and energy. And this is very important. Just because it's a scheduled sex date does not mean that it has to be penetration. It could be a makeout session. It could be watching porn together. It could be a massage. It could be a bath together. It's basically, it's time to build intimacy. So don't think of it as penetration is the end goal, orgasm is the end goal. Think of it as time spent connected, paying attention, and being mindful with each other. And lean into the anticipation of it all, you know? It'll be something you have to look forward to. And you can bring something fun for you both to try. Variety is exciting, and you can have fun with it. You can find sexual games, you could include some nice dessert, some good food. Read books on sexuality together, learn together, try new things, have a sense of humor about it. It doesn't have to be serious, it should be fun. Just building a habit and a practice, and it's taking the time to prioritize your intimacy with your partner, above all things. So, the over-under of this whole thing is that everybody has their own libido, and it fluctuates. No two are alike. If your sex drive starts interfering with your quality of life, speak to a healthcare provider or consider speaking to a sex therapist. There's so much help out there for you. There are people that want you to thrive. But just please remember, it will get better, whether it's with your partner or not. And if you're thinking to yourself, okay, I might not be ready to go see a sex therapist yet, but I really want to continue to learn and dive into my own sexuality, and I want some like conversation starters, allow me to introduce you to Beducated. Think of Beducated as the Netflix of sexual wellness. Beducated has a vast array of sexual topics to choose from tantra to kink to online dating to even how to watch porn healthily. And I love that Beducated has so many women-focused courses. It really encourages women to celebrate their sexual appetite. Some of the Beducated courses for women are female orgasm, oral sex, menstrual cycle wellness, G-spot bliss, tantra massage, yoni and lingam massage, yoni egg, kinky sex, and many, many more. As someone who often finds himself in their own head and sort of struggles to be present during sex, I've always been really curious about tantra. So I started with the Beducated course Tantra for One. It started with an overview and a history of the origin of tantra and sort of what is at the heart of that practice. The courses are presented in a very beginner-friendly way. Nothing feels sort of overwhelming or like out of your league. Once I started taking the courses and have started to integrate some tantric practices into my own life, I've already felt a shift and even started journaling my own experiences and learnings after each video. And of course, you could binge them all at once if you want to. I just personally like to spread mine out so I can really think about each individual key learning. But now that I've had a taste for tantra, I'm really excited to bring it into my relationship as well, which is great because they also have a video about tantra for couples. In this video, I was talking about sex dates or intimacy dates. I think Beducated offers you a plethora of different options and topics and conversation starters for your intimacy dates. So sign up for Beducated now and receive access to a huge library of courses. You can try all the Beducated courses for one day for free, but you also have the opportunity to get 70% off of their yearly pass with my code, Merle. And joining Beducated is only $7.99 a month. But once you get the deal, it'll be locked in for life. So check the link in my description and you can start upgrading your sex life right now.